opinion by Jay Doubs from an appeal from this courthouse, Circuit Judge Bronson, and he says, "There's no such thing as unarrest. If it's done, it's done." And that even so far is that that triggered the time for speedy trial running and dismissal, even though that particular defendant was theoretically unarrested and became an agent, didn't matter. And it says right in the opinion that the arrest type situation, custody situation for speedy trial is more so than Miranda. Miranda is a lesser standard of doing that. So in the event someone would argue, you're confused, well, they took the handcuffs off of her, the answer to that is, so what? The law says that doesn't matter. You can't do that. You can't just restrict people's freedoms. Going back after the
Mr. Mason.
The handcuffing.
Mr. Mason.
Yes, sir.
One question. At what point were the handcuffs taken off? Was it, were they taken off before she was taken over to look at these apartments?
I don't think that was clear in the record, but my belief is that they were. I don't know that for sure. She was taken to the car. She was patted down. She was put into the back seat of the car, and no one seemed to have remembered that so clearly. I can't give you a definitive on that issue. But also I want to say in the totality of the circumstances, remember now, even before the handcuffing, she is in this psychological circumstance of her mother yelling, "I want her arrested," a deputy being there, a deputy questioning her and holding her there to write a statement. And one could easily conclude that in these circumstances, the total circumstances, that she was, her restraint was curtailed right then and there. She wasn't free to go. Her liberty was restrained right then and there. And it becomes more clear and definitive when the handcuffs are put on. Now, when she's brought back from the trip with Acevedo and questioning by Fletcher and walks with Sergeant Hosey, she's questioned then, not reciting all the things that you heard, she's then questioned by Detective Mellich. He takes her into a room in the house where she and he are in there alone. That, in case somebody misreads this somewhere in Pahokee, nobody is suggesting there was any impropriety of what he did by taking her. It's just a matter of the defendant being isolated at that point from her family and put in a place where, but the door was left ajar, and I think even Cindy said she could hear the questioning from Detective Mellich, but he kept her in, he questioned her, and he continued to question her. And by the way, did not advise her of Miranda rights. They absolutely did not. There's evidence that there were harsh tones from time to time, and there's the rest of the deputies are around the house. So you have to look in through the eyes of the defendant. As a 22-year-old girl with no experience in law enforcement, contact with the criminal system, is in an environment where it would be unreasonable to suggest that she could just leave or tell them to get out of her house. That question went on, by the way, as I heard it, I think until like 3:30 in the morning. She was never told that she didn't have to talk to them. She was never told that you don't have to talk to me, by Detective Mellich or anybody else. She was never told if she wanted to leave there, she could leave. After that conclusion, roughly 3:30 in the morning, she's told they'll be back. And indeed, shortly after first light, the Sheriff's Department comes back. Sergeant John Allen and Apping Wells come back, and by the way, in my motion, I read it. I think it said Mellich and Allen, but it was Allen and Wells that actually came back and picked her up. And they took her at that time in their car, and both Cindy and George testified that they were told that by the detectives that she will not be back. That's relevant to the whole concept of totality of circumstances of her being in custody at the time and their intent. They took her to Universal Studios. They did not invite her to meet them there. When Detective Mellish left at 3:30 in the morning, he didn't say to Casey or to her mother or to her father or to her brother or any combinations thereof, will you meet us at Universal in the morning? Will you bring her to Universal in the morning? And so forth. Wasn't done at all because there was no intent to let her go from there. I submit the evidence is pretty compelling that she was continually in a situation where any reasonable person would believe she was in custody. She was taken to Universal Studios where they were met by yet another law enforcement type, that is Mr. Turturro, the head of security for Universal. So there's four big guys and 110 pounds, and they walk around and she's going to show them where she worked. If I recall, two in front, two in back, in a secured area, not open to the public. And they take her down a hallway. I think the prosecution put in a map of the route that they walked. It's not in dispute. She acknowledges she doesn't work there anymore. Whereupon they put her in a small conference room, described from the witness stand as being a 10-foot by 10-foot room.
A room a lot smaller than your area, right here where you are and me. With three armed detectives
and her. And they did not advise her Miranda warning rights. And they closed the door. And they kept her in there until two of them left and the doors stayed closed and she's still in there. They say, I think, that the door was closed for privacy. Well, I'm interested in not so much what they say as what the facts say to a reasonable person. Is she free to go? She's 20 miles from home. She has no car. She has nobody with her. And what is she going to do? Tell these guys, I'm out of here, see you, and what are they going to do? I get better odds of winning the lottery than believing that they didn't intend to keep her there. The facts are screaming. So, having that background, the legal issue is whether a reasonable person would believe that her freedom of action was curtailed to a degree associated with arrest. Or said another way, if her freedom was deprived in any significant way. I sent you some time ago, a week or two ago, I can't remember, a letter with a bibliography of cases. I didn't receive anything like that from the other side. I guess they're not obligated to, but I sent them so your team would have some advance look at what some of the law is.
Unfortunately, Mr. Mason.
I understand.
They only go in the direction I sent them, but they'll tell you most of the research I did.
And that's the letter was addressed to you. One of the cases to talk about this.
Are you familiar with the case of Parks versus State?
Hawks versus State, yes.
Parks.
P-A-R-K-S.
644 7 Second 106, a 4th District Court of Appeals case decided 1994.
I am not. Okay. Not as we stand here right now. I can't be sure. I want to bring the court to
I would be interested at some point as to your take on that case.
Okay. Well, it won't be.
I know it won't be today.
I'll give you the rest of the ones to talk about on this totality of circumstances. There are several that I think are important, and I wanted to address them with you because I'm sure you will deal with them. The case of Ross versus State, Judge, that's the Florida Supreme Court. Rehearing denied September 8, 2010. And it's found at 45 7 3rd, 403. I think it is, illustrative of the various positions that I'm saying to you about the totality of the circumstances, and just, we belabor some of these things historically, we should. If you remember in school, I know you didn't remember it in person, the Miranda decision, the Chief Justice of the United States Supreme Court stated that even the Chief Justice of the United States Supreme Court is entitled to have the Miranda warnings advised to him. Any individual is entitled to that. I think the Ross court says, if you go through all the things this, in the totality of the circumstances, they have to be examined. And they cite, as do so many other cases, this is how a reasonable person in a suspect situation would perceive his or her circumstances. That's why I give the history of the whole, we arrived with a call, questioning, the confrontation, and so forth. And was her freedom curtailed? And the Supreme Court goes further at page 416 and also advises that one of the factors that have to be considered is that the defendant was never informed he was free to leave. And we know historically and categorically in this case that she was never informed that she had a right to leave or to terminate the questioning. Ms. Burdick, in her cross-examination of several of the witnesses, asked some questions of some similar pattern. Did you point a gun at her? Did you make her stay? Did she ever tell you she wanted to leave? Did she ever tell you she wanted a lawyer? And I was listening to that, and I'm making notes of myself. Apparently, there's something new, and that is that a defendant is now obligated to invoke their own Miranda rights, notwithstanding the Supreme Court of the United States and the Supreme Court of Florida. And I said, well, that doesn't make a whole lot of sense. It's not her obligation to do that. It's the law enforcement officer's obligation to do that with the citizen when they confront them and they restrain their freedom. And I think the Ross case is helpful in that regard as well. The one case I also know that if you have not, you will find, and I did cite it because it's not necessarily the best case in my position, but that's the case of State v. Shell, and that's the Second District Court of Appeal, 2006, and it's found at 932 Southern 2nd 628. However, it does stand for propositions actually that support our position. The distinction facts there is that that defendant was invited to go down to the child protective team to meet the law enforcement people, and where she went with her sister, and she drove her a car, and she got down there, and then they questioned her, and that was entirely a voluntary situation on her part. But even with in the body of the Shell decision at page 631, they talk about Miranda. Again, reiterating, whether a reasonable person placed in the same position would believe that his or her freedom of action was curtailed to a degree associated with actual arrest. And they cite the Mansfield case on the Florida Supreme Court in 2000 and Ramirez, which I'll mention again later.